Well, good morning. It's good to see you here in the Lord's house this morning. Thank you for taking time out of your Sunday to be here. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we realize that there's so much sadness and strife going on in the world, and we are so grateful that you give us this haven of rest, this church that we can come to and leave all that behind for the next 45 minutes, Lord. Give me the words to say to bring encouragement and joy and enlightenment to these good people. And Lord, thank you for having your hand of blessing upon us during our difficult times. And may we just be blessed because of it. And Lord, just see us through it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The first song is a happy song, number 117, A Shelter in the Time of Storm. And that is, God is certainly that. Number 117, A Shelter in the Time of Storm.
The Lord's our rock, in Him we hide, a shelter in the time of storm. Procure whatever ill betide, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. A shade by day, defense by night, a shelter in the time of storm. No fears alarm, no fears of fright, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. The raging storms may round us beat, a shelter in the time of storm. We'll never leave a safe retreat, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, rock divine, a refuge dear, a shelter in the time of storm. Be thou our helper ever near, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm.
Amen. Thank you for that. Our unison reading is a familiar story to, I'm sure, most of you. It is about the lost sheep. It's a parable. Please stand as you are comfortable and able to stand as I invite Mrs. Amanda Rockar to the pulpit to lead us in this reading.
What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his neighbors, saying unto them, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance.
May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word, and you may be seated.
Thank you, Linda.
My lesson today may seem a little self-indulgent at first. I don't mean for it to be. I just need to talk about a few personal things before I get to the lesson at hand. But this is July, and most years in July, I can't help but hearken back to July 2005 when I first walked through the front doors of this church. Well, truth to tell, July 2005 wasn't the first time I walked through those doors. I attended this church faithfully as both a little boy and as a teenager, but that was a couple decades prior. I returned to this church in July 2005 with my elderly parents in tow. I was looking for a pastor to minister to them, and when their times would come, I needed a pastor to officiate my mother and my father's funerals. Little did I know, and truthfully I did not know at that time, that the pastor I was looking for was me. You see, in July 2005, I was freshly out of the ministry. I'd been in the full-time ministry for several years, but that all ended with a bang, or maybe it ended with a whimper. I suppose it all depends on who you ask. But either way, I had been hurt, and I was done, and I had no plans of ever going back into the church biz. Well, as I very often say to you, if you want to make God laugh, make plans. And no doubt God got a very good chuckle at me in July 2005, because you see, I didn't know it, but God planned for me to be voted in as pastor of this church 6 months afterward. And this church has been a blessing to me ever since. Now, that's not to say that the Norvelt Union Church didn't present me with many challenges, especially during those early lean years. First of all, I have this weird habit that I want to eat and pay my bills. And I knew right away that if I were to take on this little church at that time, I would have to find another source of income. But all I could find were part-time jobs. So I ended up working 5 steady part-time bookkeeping jobs just to make ends meet. And as if working around the clock was not enough, on top of that, my parents needed my attention. My father had Alzheimer's and my mother had diabetes, and eventually she developed colon cancer. Now, I'm not saying all that for a pity party. I am neither bragging nor am I complaining. I mention these facts only to set the stage for the next point. But from January 2006, when I officially became the pastor of this church, to about November 2011, when my father died, those 5.5 years were undoubtedly the busiest era of my life to date. Those 5.5 years were and are still a blur to me. And if it were not for the grace of God, I would not have gotten through them. Figuratively speaking, I was like a poor juggler. I admit I dropped a few balls because there were far too many to keep in the air. As your pastor back then, I'm sure I made some bad decisions. I have no doubt I preached some bad sermons. I know there were more than a few Sundays I stepped into this pulpit more occupied with my own pressures than I was with feeding you a well-prepared, spiritually uplifting, biblical, edifying sermon. And I'm very sorry about that. Yet somehow God still managed to use my ill-prepared sermons and my lack of giving this place my undivided attention to build a viable, thriving ministry here. But I guess that should be no surprise. I mean, if the Lord can turn water into wine, he can certainly turn my flawed efforts into something worthwhile. That being said, I've since forgiven myself for all that. There's no point in beating oneself up over the past. I relieved myself of all accountability from anything I've done or any decision I made or any attitude I had or from any sermon I preached from January 2006 to November 2011. And I said all that to say this. Because I was so busy, certain things had to be pushed aside for just the sake of time. Priorities had to be made. And some things had to be abandoned. And one of the things that had to go by the wayside was taking the time and expensing the energy chasing people back to this church who had previously left. Believe it or not, not everyone takes a shine to me. I know, that's hard to believe. 16 years ago, people would hear that this church got a new pastor, and they'd say, yay! And they would come once or twice and not either like my sermon or my sense of humor. It was usually my sense of humor. And they wouldn't come back. I understand that I'm not everyone's cup of tea, but fortunately for them, the Lord makes pastors in all shapes and sizes, doctrines and personalities. But then there were others, and amen, who would come a good while, week after week, get on board, get involved, maybe even join the church and make this church their home. And most of them are still here. Amen. But then time would go on and an occasional member would miss one Sunday, come back one Sunday, then miss two Sundays, come back one Sunday. This time they would avoid making eye contact with me. And then they would miss three Sundays and come back one Sunday and sit in the back so they can get out of here without talking to me when we're dismissed. And eventually they would just disappear. You see, I found that most church members don't abruptly quit. If they abruptly quit, you notice, they rather seem to just fade away. Several weeks, maybe a couple months would go by and somebody would say, hey, Pastor, where's Joe Schmo been? And I think, you're right. Come to think of it, can't remember the last time I saw Joe Schmo. And then maybe somebody else would chime in, well, I hear Joe's been going to the Sacred Martyr with a bleeding dagger in her skull church. Someone else might chime in, well, I heard Joe is visiting the Prosperous, Successful, Joyous Existence Life Church. Now, obviously, I changed the names to protect the innocent. Hey, Pastor, you better do something. You better go chase after Joe and get him back here, or you're going to lose him for good. But such advice from that well-meaning church member would be met with my exhaustion. What that well-meaning church member didn't realize was back during those early years, it was always tax season at work. I might have a funeral on Monday. Maybe Mom had a doctor's appointment on Tuesday. Dad would have one on Thursday. And just think, another Sunday's coming around and I haven't even started my sermon yet. So I would say to myself, well, Joe will just have to wait another week. I'll chase Joe next week. I'll chase him back to this church. But the next week was no better. Long story long, I would never get the opportunity or take the opportunity to chase after Joe, and Joe Schmo would end up joining one of the other churches. So during this busy time in my life, I developed three attitudes. Some might call them policies or personal justifications about not chasing those who would leave the church. My first justification was, in the time and energy it takes for me to set up a meeting with Joe and then try to convince him to come back to church and then having to sit there and listen to him telling me how disappointing I am as a pastor, I could take that same time and that same energy and actually write a better sermon that week for those of you who are faithful, for those of you who have not left, and maybe even have enough time left over to visit a rest home or a hospital. Years ago, I ran into one of our former church members. They told me they were going to another pastor's church because when their father was having an operation, the other pastor came and prayed by their father's bedside. And I couldn't do this because I had a job to go to that morning. And I knew this other pastor. He was a nice guy, but his church paid him like 80 grand a year. And I wanted to say to this former member, you know what, if you pay me 80 grand a year, I'll not only go visit your father in the hospital, I'll move in with him, feed him, bath him, and help him with his rehab. But I didn't say that. I instead smiled and wished the person well, never revealing that my feelings were hurt. In short, there's only so much time in the week, but then I developed the attitude that I need to use my precious time wisely, keeping you faithful members satisfied instead of using that time unsuccessfully trying to chase back those few who are disgruntled. My second justification is not chasing the Joe Schmoes in the world was I considered that leaving our church might just be God's will for Joe Schmo's life. You know, we pastors often make the mistakes of thinking that we are the only ones praying for God's will. So only we believe we know what is best for you. But how do I know that Joe Schmo isn't also praying for God's will for his own life? And God told him to take a break from our church and go visit a few other churches. Can I be so certain that the good Lord doesn't have a role waiting for Joe to fulfill at another church? Well, I don't want to get in the way of the Lord's will. Plus, if I give Joe enough space and not impose upon him, he just might realize that this is the best church in the world, and maybe he'll come back. My third justification for not chasing after Joe Schmo is that I think we have it the wrong way around. Consider this. If a father abandons his family, he doesn't demand an explanation from his family. No, it is the father who owes the family the explanation. If an employee decides to abandon his job, it's not the boss who owes the employee a reason. No, the employee should explain his absence to the boss. That being said, none of you owe me an explanation. Nobody here owes me an explanation. You're all adults. This is America. You are free to come and go as you please. I'm just saying that if an explanation is called for, I'm not the one who needs to provide it. I'm still here. I've not abandoned anything. I'm still here doing exactly what I was hired to do. And until I'm not, I believe I owe no one an explanation. So those were my three justifications, my three trains of thought, which I used for years to justify not chasing back members who had chosen to vacate this church. And I'm sure you agree that these justifications are fine. They're certainly reasonable and they're understandable. There's only one tiny little problem with them. There's only one problem in holding to them. In Luke 15, Jesus gives us a parable about a lost sheep. And this is a sweet, lovely parable full of God's truth, but truth to tell, sometimes I wish it wasn't in the Bible. You know the story. It was our unison reading this morning. Once upon a time, a shepherd has 100 sheep, but one day he counts only 99. One of his sheep is missing. And most shepherds would have counted their losses. I mean, 99 sheep is still a pretty sizable flock. So what if one were missing? That's an acceptable loss. But you see, this isn't just any ordinary shepherd. He is a good shepherd. He does not even want to withstand the loss of one little troublesome lamb. So he leaves the 99 and he goes on the search for that lost one. And he does not stop until he finds him. And when the shepherd does find that lost little lamb, he lays it upon his shoulders, he carries it back home, and the shepherd rejoices more over the lost lamb, no longer lost, than for the 99 he left behind. Now I realize this parable is not really a parallel to the subject at hand. The parable of the lost sheep is about salvation. It's not about a disgruntled church member leaving the fold. How do I know this? Well, Jesus compares the 99 sheep left behind to 99 sinners who have justified their sins for themselves, yet they mistakenly believe they do not need repentance. But all that being said, we are to be like Jesus. And Jesus has a passion for the lost. A passion so great that he freely gave up himself to be sacrificed on the cross for the lost. If we are to be like Jesus, then I need, to have that same passion for the lost to be found, for the lost to be saved. Let's all bring this lesson home. How can I be so sure? How can I be so certain that Joe Schmo isn't a lost sheep? How can I be so certain that Joe Schmo doesn't need salvation? And the truth is, I don't. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why we need the Holy Spirit to guide us in each one of these circumstances. I mean, holding to my silly three policies, my three justifications, doesn't work in every case. There are not one size fits all. Because when a sheep leaves the flock, we don't know if that Joe Schmo is simply a disgruntled Christian looking for a better church, or is he a lost lamb running away from salvation. Because if he is a lost lamb, and not merely a disgruntled sheep, We must follow him. I must follow the example of the shepherd and seek after him, invite him back into the fold, and share the gospel with him and pray that he gets saved this time. Oh, if all the sheep in the Lord's flock would mimic the passion of the shepherd for the lost, there'd be no end to the rejoicing, not only here in our church, but also in heaven above. If there's nothing further, take your hymnals once again. This time turn to page number 128. The song is Face to Face, number 128. Face to face with Christ, my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? When with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ who died for me. Face to face I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory, I shall see him by and by. Only faintly now I see him, with a darkened veil between. What a blessed day is coming, when his glory shall be seen. Face to face I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory, I shall see him by and by. When rejoicing in his presence, when our banished grief and pain, when the crooked ways are straightened and the dark things shall be plain, face to face I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory, I shall see him by and by. Face to face, O blissful moment, face to face to see and know, face to face with my Redeemer, me so. Face to face I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory, I shall see him by and by. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This morning we're going to have a responsive reading. It comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 10. Please stand if you're able and comfortable as I invite Brian Evans to the pulpit to lead us in this reading.
Good job.
You're doing well.
Thank you. But ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep.
As I said unto you, my sheep hear my voice.
And I know them.
And they follow me.
And I give unto them eternal life.
And they shall never perish.
Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand.
My Father which gave them me is greater than all.
And no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand.
I and my Father are one.
You may be seated. Thank you, Brother Brian.
Our responsive reading today depicts the Lord as our shepherd, and we, those of us who believe in our shepherd, are his sheep. Our responsive reading goes on to say that we, his sheep, recognize the shepherd's voice and that no one can pluck us out of the shepherd's hands. This is the relationship between he, the shepherd, and us, we sheep. It's a nice pairing, and I wouldn't change it for the world. Yet there's a little bit of unknown, there's an unknown element at the beginning of this pairing between shepherd and sheep. Did the shepherd choose the sheep, or did the sheep choose the shepherd? From among all the sheep in all the world, did the shepherd hand select those who would be part of his flock, or did we, the sheep, choose him to be our shepherd? In short, was the pairing his idea or ours? Who made the first move? And if you're like anything like me, you're saying, what difference does it make? I mean, really, as long as we are paired together with the shepherd, it's like a marriage. I mean, what does it matter who proposed to whom as long as the couple lives happily ever after? And I would agree with that. But there are Bible scholars throughout the centuries who have debated this extensively. Let me give you a very short historical background on this. The idea that the shepherd chooses the sheep is better known as a point of Calvinism. The philosophy of Calvinism is named after the 6th century French theologian named John Calvin. The idea that the sheep choose the shepherd is better known as a point of Arminianism. The philosophy of Arminianism is named after the 16th century Dutch theologian, a man named Jacobus Arminius. Very briefly put, Arminianism and Calvinism, for the better part, are opposing theories. These two have been debated for nearly 500 years. Hundreds of books have been written on this subject. Hundreds of lectures have been taught on these topics. Calvinism disputes Arminianism, and Arminianists dispute Calvinists. But what makes this dispute interesting is that there seems to be no third choice. As a Christian, you're either one or the other. And I'm far from an expert on this doctrine. I've forgotten most of what I learned in school. I've said this, and I mean this, every word of it. Nothing I learned out there prepared me for being your pastor in here. Nothing. What I gleaned from this is sitting in the pew, listening to good preaching all my life. Well, most of my life. And my personal life, my personal prayer life and study life with Jesus Christ. And of course, with the Lord, and of course, the leading of the Holy Spirit. That being said, I had this in school, but I don't remember most of it or all of it. But for those of you who are more versed on this thing than I am, I admit that I am oversimplifying these two complex trains of thought. And for any deep theologians in the room or watching from home, please be patient with me. To further explain these two theories, let's go to the pet store. The parents of a little boy give him permission and the cash to buy his first little puppy. And the boy runs over to this big enclosed area where there's these oh-so-cute. Anyone have a preference of what kind of puppy it is? Beagle? Will Beagle be okay? Okay. The boy runs over to this area where these oh-so-cute little beagles are frolicking, freely paying no attention to the little boy. The little boy looks over all of them carefully. In time, he decides on the one he likes. So he reaches down and scoops up that one puppy in his arms. And the puppy may even struggle a little bit to get free from the little boy. But the boy holds on because he is determined that he is going to make this puppy his. With the puppy in his arms, the boy declares, "I'll take this one. I love him. I'll call him Scooter." And the boy and his parents, they walk over with Scooter to the cash register and they make their purchase. Well, I would consider that purchase, I would equate that to Calvinism. Let's go back to the pet store. This time, the parents of a little girl give their permission and her money to buy her first puppy. And the little girl walks into the pet store and immediately she is spied by a golden retriever. What did we decide on? Beagle. It was golden retriever the last service. This little beagle puppy spies the little girl before the girl's even in the door. Before this little girl can even get close to the puppy play area, the beagle puppy escapes, runs over to the little girl and jumps into her arms. Do beagles jump? You have to be really low though. Without even examining the other puppies, the little girl says, "Look, Mommy and Daddy, this one wants me to take her home. She loves me, I'll call her Lady." And ladies and gentlemen, this second puppy purchase is equated with Arminianism. And of course, in each of these examples, the little kid represents God and the puppies represent us. The theory of Calvinism basically teaches us that the Lord looks upon all of us, but only scoops up those who he wants in his flock. The theory of Arminianism teaches, although we could all choose the Lord, only a few of us will jump in the Lord's arms. In short, it comes down to who chose who. Did the Lord choose us or did we choose the Lord? And seemingly there is precedent in the Bible for both of these. Calvinists often point to the story of the Apostle Paul. You know his story. Before he was the Apostle Paul, he was known as Saul, the persecutor of Christians. That is until one day God looks down as Saul was on his road to Damascus to persecute some Christians. And God decides, I'm going to make him one of mine. I'm going to make him one of my sheep. Now, Saul wasn't looking to convert himself to the ways of Christianity. He thought his life was good and he was satisfied with that. But God interrupts Saul's journey, strikes him blind. God tells Saul that he was chosen and scared out of his wits. Saul says, okay. He becomes the Apostle Paul. The rest is history. Paul becomes arguably one of the greatest champions of Christ, up there with Simon Peter and John the Baptist. How did Paul become a follower of Christ? The Lord chose Paul. However, Arminianists point to the biblical examples like that of Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a rich ruler who sought after the Lord. In fact, Nicodemus had such a hunger for the Lord's teachings and the ways of Jesus Christ, he snuck out at night and tracked Jesus down. There was something about Jesus that just attracted Nicodemus to him. And Nicodemus went right for it, and on that historic night, Jesus tells Nicodemus that he must be born again to see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus trusts in Jesus, and Jesus becomes Nicodemus' Lord and Savior. Nicodemus, in fact, becomes so loyal, such a loyal follower, that later he is the one who provides the myrrh and the aloes for Jesus' dead body after the resurrection. So how does Nicodemus become a follower of Christ? Well, Nicodemus chooses the Lord. So ladies and gentlemen, I won't ask for a show of hands, although I think that'd be fun. How was it for you? Do you feel God chose you, or did you choose God? Now, if you're not exactly sure which is which, I did come up with a test to help us determine exactly that. This test isn't scientific. It is not without its flaws, but it is thought-provoking. Maybe it'll get us all to think of these things. I want you all to picture something a little silly. Please bear with me. You and Jesus Christ are taking a road trip. Your Christian life is a journey, we believe. You are traveling along in a vehicle, a vessel with Jesus Christ. Perhaps the two of you are in a car or a plane or a boat. It doesn't matter, but we'll say car because did anyone come here today by boat? Okay, so car. Okay, well, let's choose car. You and the Lord are driving along the highway of life. Can you picture it? Can you clearly picture your cross-country journey with Jesus? Just you and he both in a car. Close your eyes if you have to imagine this. Now, does everyone have a vivid picture in their mind? Just Jesus and you driving along. As you picture this road trip with your Savior clearly in your mind, answer me this. Who is driving? Who is behind the steering wheel? If you are driving, you are no doubt an Arminianist. If Jesus is doing the driving, you are no doubt a Calvinist. Why is the conflict between these two theories so contested? Well, because simply put, some see it as a conflict between grace and faith. What saves us, grace or faith? Are we saved by God's grace, or are we saved by our faith? Which was the greater ingredient in our salvation? Those who say they are saved more by grace than faith are accused of diminishing faith. Those who say they are saved more by faith than grace are accused of diminishing God's grace. But I say you need both. We need to have faith in God's grace. Yet God's grace is meaningless if we have no faith in it. Salvation is an agreement, a contract, a covenant between two parties. You need both. We bring the faith, God brings the grace. We all bring something to the table. The problem with many Christians is that they think that their experience is the only correct experience. If I am saved with Jesus on the passenger side, then that must be the only way anyone can be saved. If I am saved with Jesus in the driver's seat, then there can be no other way for salvation. But I believe it can be both. Although there is only one true shepherd, however, we sheep come in all shapes and sizes. Just because your salvation experience is a little different than your Christian neighbor doesn't necessarily mean that one of you is amiss. All that matters is in the end. Is the Lord our shepherd? That's all that matters. How we got together, how we paired off, the path we took to make that happen is really irrelevant. In fact, we sing in Amazing Grace when we've been there 10,000 years. When we've been there 10,000 years. How the pairing happened won't matter in the slightest. But I ask you today, ladies and gentlemen, is the Lord your shepherd? Are you his sheep? If not, as we go to pray in the quietness of your own seat, just tell the Lord, thank you, Lord, for being my shepherd. I accept you. I accept your son's death on the cross as payment for my sins. And Lord, I want to be one of your sheep. I want to be called to that great fold in heaven one day when we are all gathered together on that great reunion day. Just pray those words. Accept the Lord. Put away all the pride. Put away all the silliness, these arguments that we Christians have been having for centuries. What all that matters is, are you saved? Is the Lord your shepherd? Let's go to prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I do thank you that you are my shepherd. I have no doubt to believe you are everyone in this room calls you their shepherd. But if there is one among us, may they make their calling and election sure. May in the quietness of their own seats, may they get their accounts straight with you. And may they give up any sort of silly notion that the world has to offer them about salvation. And maybe they just trust in you and solely you and only you so that they too can be in heaven one day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand if you're able. And comfortable. We're going to go back to an old favorite, number 417, Just As I Am Without One Plea. Just one verse today. Number 417, Just As I Am Without One Plea.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
Board members, we do have a meeting after you say your goodbyes and be friendly with everybody. We're going to have a meeting downstairs in just a little bit. At this point, I'm going to invite Brother Mike Thomas to the pulpit to close us in prayer. Brother Mike.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this day and the opportunity to gather in your house, Lord. We give you thanks for the message that was prepared for us today. We ask that you help lead us and guide us and keep us safe until we all come together again. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen. And thank you for coming. You are dismissed. It is cooler in here.